Okay, great. He did it. Yay.
So, this is cool stuff up here.
Yeah.
I mean,
this is all this stuff. We had a Parker.
This is like.
Thank you. Good morning. Friends, it is good to be together this morning. Whether you are showing up with a weary heart, a breaking heart, whether you are showing up with fear and anxiety, or a sacred rage, whether you're showing up for yourself or for someone else, thank you for showing up. We are so glad you're here. Welcome to Theodore Parker Church. I'm the Reverend Heather Concannon. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm the minister of this congregation. And as we enter into worship this morning, we bring all of who we are here to the altar of community. Our tears, our stubborn hope, our love for this beautiful and heartbreaking world. Know that whoever you are and however you arrive this morning, whether today is your first day here or your thousandth time here, if you come in a spirit of love, you are welcome here. I want to extend a special welcome to those of us who are joining us for the first time this morning. And if you're new or visiting today, we invite you to fill out a connection card, which will either be in your pews or on the Zoom chat, so we can help to greet you more fully. This morning, I also want to extend a special welcome to Jonathan Kessler, our new acting director of music ministry. Those of us who have been in the congregation for a little while will know that we have had a long search for a new music director. And though this is a somber day for many of us, we are also so excited that you're here, Jonathan, and we look forward to offering you a warm welcome. For those joining us in person today, a few things you may want to know about our space. Our congregation is mask optional, and if you'd like to be seated where others are also wearing a mask, this section is reserved for those wearing masks. In your pews, you can scan the QR code that is taped to the back of the pews to pull up our order of service. If you'd like to take a look at that during the service, we'll also have the slides projected, and at either entrance, there are large print orders of service as well. Today, our service is being recorded and will be available on YouTube later. And if you would like to share a joy or a concern later during our prayer time and meditation time, we have cards right here where you can write down a joy or a concern and anytime before our meditation hymn, and you can also light a silent candle anytime during our service. There's also a space in the back for private reflection as well. People of all ages are welcome to move about the sanctuary as they need to or to make themselves comfortable in our cozy zone right here in front of the pews. And children's programming for elementary school-aged kids will be happening today, and we also have childcare available for children under four happening in our nursery, which is in our parish hall. And lastly, I just want to offer a reminder to take care of yourselves during the service. If you need to get up and stretch or use the bathroom, which is through those doors in the back, or sit on the front steps in the fresh, crisp air for a few minutes, you are very much encouraged to do what you need to do to take care of yourself. And this is always true, but especially so today. So we'd like to take a moment to greet one another. For those of us on Zoom, putting our video on, your video on, would help us connect. And if you are in the sanctuary, I invite us to give a big wave to the folks on Zoom. The camera is right below the clock. Good morning, friends. And as we continue to greet each other, if you're online, I invite you to post a hello in the chat. And if you're here in the sanctuary, I invite you to greet one another and say good morning. Please greet each other.
We are so glad you're here. Thank you.
Our prelude will be Remembering the Rain by Bill Evans.
Good morning. My name is Rose Gologli. I use she, her pronouns, and I serve as this congregation's religious educator. I'm glad to share our opening words this morning, which are from the Reverend Peggy Clark. Come in and bring everything you have. Drag in your fear, your doubt, your anger. Carry with you your heartbreak, your desperation, your feelings of being small, or alone, or abandoned. Leave nothing by the door for you to pick up on your way out. Bring it all in, here, to your people, even if you don't know a soul in the room. We are here for each other. We are what we have. We are what we need. Let's make room for each in our fullness. And let's make room for faith, hope, and love, which are also today looking for a home. Even in this hard, cold space, we can create softness. We can create welcome. We can create warmth, where all of who we are can rest. Our opening hymn this morning is Meditation on Breathing, which is number 109 in your teal hymnal. Before we sing together, I want to share just a bit about where this hymn came from. UU musician Sarah Dan Jones wrote it directly after 9/11. She said that she felt so full of despair in that moment and needed to channel that into some hope. In the 20 plus years since, this song has taken on a life of its own. It's been sung at vigils following school shootings, at rallies and direct actions as folks are being arrested, by parents singing their children to sleep at the bedside in hospice care. So as we sing together this morning, may we feel connected to the energy and power of all who have taken solace in this song before us, connected across time and space, both in our despair and our insistence on the possibility of peace and hope. Please rise in body or in spirit and join me in singing. The words will also be up on the screen.
Thank you.
one of the things that we do each week in Unitarian Universalist congregations is to light our chalice, which is the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith, right up here on the altar, on the chancel. And I just want to remind us, I preached about this earlier this fall, but I just want to remind us of the story of the chalice very briefly. The chalice was a symbol created in World War II by artist Hans Deutsch as the Unitarian Service Committee was working to get people out of Nazi-occupied Europe. And it was a symbol created to make the paperwork look more official. And I think of this symbol as a deeply liberatory and deeply anti-fascist symbol. And as we light it in our worship service today, I want to bring that long legacy of fighting for liberation and justice and the well-being of all people into our space today. So, Eleanor, I hear you're going to light our chalice this morning. And as Eleanor lights our chalice, I invite us to say together our covenant, once in English and once in Spanish, in honor of our sibling congregation in Plazuelas, El Salvador. The words will be up on your screen. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its prayer. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek truth in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de esta iglesia y el servicio es nuestra oración. Esta es nuestra gran promesa, vivir juntos en paz, buscar la verdad con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
This morning, the message I have is really specifically for the children of the congregation. So I actually want to invite you all, if you want to come closer and sit with me on the steps. Do you hear our message? Nothing. Anyone who wants to. I am imagining that a lot of you have seen some of the adults in your life feel pretty sad or scared or angry this week. Is that right? And I think that you all know that that's because this Tuesday we had an election and Trump, who has said a lot of terrible things, said and done a lot of terrible things, won the election. So he gets to be our next president. And Trump, in particular, has said a lot of terrible things about immigrants, about people of color, about queer and trans people, and about women. And all of us here are either in those groups or love people who are. So a lot of us are feeling scared right now, even though we don't know yet what he might be able to do or what was going to happen. Because there are a lot of things that we don't know yet, I want to talk with you all about what we do know, because we also do know a lot of things. We know that there are a lot of people all around this country, in this world, who believe in and value the same things that we do, and will keep fighting to keep us safe. We know that that includes peoples who are still in our government, particularly in our local government here, that we might be able to be a resource and support for people in other parts of the country with less nice local governments. And we all know, in particular, especially for sure, that all of us here in this room, all of us in this congregation, and everyone who loves us is going to keep, we're going to keep loving each other, and we're going to fight to keep each other safe. Everyone in this room, in this congregation, and everyone who loves each of us, That's so many people. That's so many people. And all of us are going to keep loving each other. And we're going to fight to keep each other safe. Congregation, I wonder if you can say those words with me to affirm our message. You can repeat after me. Say, we love you.
We love you.
We're going to keep fighting to keep each other safe. Let's do that one more time. And also, I'm going to invite you all, this is a message to our children and also to each of us. So, we love you.
We love you.
We're going to fight to keep each other safe. One last thing I want to say to you all is a reminder that this congregation here is over 300 years old. Did you know that? 300, well, more than 300 years.
I didn't know that.
It's a long time.
Yay!
It's a long time. And in that time, this congregation has seen so many different things, right? That means that we've been through multiple wars and pandemics, depressions, times of really deep injustice, and times of hope and progress. We know that this congregation has been there for people on the worst day of their lives and on the best day. Sometimes that's on the very same day. We know that even just in the past 8 years, we've all been through a lot together. We've been through the last Trump presidency. We've been through the pandemic. We've been through a lot of ordinary, joyful, and heartbreaking things in our own lives. And we're still here. We're still here. We're still loving each other. We're still fighting to keep each other safe. Let's say that one more time together, okay? Ready? We love you.
We love you.
We're going to fight to keep each other safe. Thank you all. I hope that this is a message we can all hold in our hearts and return to in whatever is to come. Now we're going to go to Children's Chapel. I invite you all to join me in singing our children's benediction to sing our children out today.
Friends, we deepen into a space of meditation and prayer. And as we do so, I invite you to enter into this moment here and now. Take a few slow breaths and find inside yourself a space of stillness. If you're here in the sanctuary this morning and you would like to include a joy or a concern, I invite you to fill out a prayer card during our meditation hymn. And if you're joining us on Zoom and you'd like to have one read aloud, I invite you to type that into the chat now. So let's remain seated and join in singing our centering hymn, Loosen. The words will be on the screen.
Thank you.
This morning we have a joy from Claire Barker in memory of the vibrant life of Dan Gleason, who died last month from Alzheimer's disease. A prayer of hope from Claire Barker for humility as we move forward. An anonymous prayer of joy. This year marks 160 years since Olympia Brown became the first woman installed as minister in a Unitarian congregation. I'm thankful we continue to fight for equality and inclusion of all identities. And friends, I know that we also carry so many joys and so many concerns unspoken in our hearts. And for all of these that remain unspoken, we light a candle. And I invite us into a space of meditation and prayer. Holy One, Spirit of life and breath, sometimes there are no words to say. Sometimes there are too many words to say. So for these moments here, now, we just breathe. For these moments, we just feel our bodies present in this space. For these moments, we feel our feet on the ground, imagining roots flowing from our feet down into the earth. For these moments, we simply notice all those gathered around us. Gratitude for comrades and companions, reminding us that we are not alone. For these moments, we remember the ancestors who came before us, all at our backs, a cloud of witnesses who give us strength. For these moments, we just breathe. And together we breathe into several moments of shared silence, followed by our musical meditation. Amen.
Each week, we take an offering to sustain the many ministries of this congregation. We give because we believe that we are part of something larger than ourselves. We give because we believe in music and sacred space, in transformation and in hope, in community and in love. We give because we know that it takes all of us sharing our many gifts to make this space possible, with the faith that together, we have more than enough. Links to donate will be in the chat and on the screen, and ushers will be coming around if you wish to give via cash or check. As Marcia shares Plowshare Prayer by Spencer LaJoy, an offering to sustain this congregation will be gratefully received. Today's reading comes from the American writer Rebecca Solnit. They want you to feel powerless and to surrender and to let them trample everything, and you are not going to let them. You are not giving up, and neither am I. The fact that we cannot save everything does not mean we cannot save anything. And everything we can save is worth saving. You may need to grieve or scream or take time off, but you have a role no matter what. And right now, good friends, and good principles are worth gathering in. Remember what you love. Remember what loves you. Remember in this time of hate what love is. The pain you feel is because of what you love. The Wobblies used to say, don't mourn, organize, but you can do both at once, and you don't have to organize right away in this moment of furious mourning. You can be heartbroken or furious both at once. You can scream in your car or on a cliff. You can also get up tomorrow and water the flower pots and call someone who's upset and check your equipment for going onward. A lot of us are going to come under direct attack, and a lot of us are going to resist by building solidarity and sanctuary. Gather up your resources, the metaphysical ones that are heart and soul and care, as well as the practical ones. People kept the faith in the dictatorships of South America in the 1970s and 1980s, and in the East Bloc countries and in the USSR. Women are protesting right now in Iran, and people there are writing poetry. There is no alternative to persevering, and that does not require you to feel good. You can keep on walking, whether it's sunny or raining. Take care of yourself, and remember that taking care of something else is an important part of taking care of yourself. Because you are interwoven with the 10 trillion things in the single garment of destiny that has been stained and torn, but is still being woven and mended and washed. So ends the reading.
Friends, I wanted to do the sermon down here this morning with all of you. On Wednesday morning, before I checked the news, I opened my text messages. My sister had texted, my 4-year-old lay down and sobbed when I told her about the election. My mom texted back, aw, baby, me too, me too. My heart sank into my stomach. I will confess that the next thought that entered my brain was a long and drawn-out expletive, but that was how I found out. And I talked to my sister later that day. She said, I lied to her. I told her we were disappointed that the meaner person won, but that she's safe. She's safe. This is my 4-year-old niece who is growing up female, my 4-year-old niece who is Black Haitian, my 4-year-old niece whose dad is a transgender man, my 4-year-old niece who is not yet legally adopted, and my 4-year-old niece who knows already too much, more than any child should know, about the heartbreak and the cruelty of the world. You're safe, my sister told her. You're safe. It's what she needed to hear, she said, but I don't know that it's true. I've had this conversation many times over the last 4 days with friends about what we told the kids. Another friend said, I couldn't bring myself to say, you're going to be fine, especially not to my 6-year-old daughter. And I know that this heartbreak and this gutted feeling and this fear and this loss of words, the rage that so many of us are feeling, I know it's not just on behalf of our kids. Right? It's on behalf of all of us who deserve so much more, all of us who deserve a livable climate, all of us who deserve control over our own bodies and access to healthcare and safe places to live. It's on behalf of what we love and what we stand to lose. And friends, I want you to know that as your minister, I am right in there with you. I'm right in there with the worry and in the what the hell happened and in the knowing it's going to be bad, but not really knowing how, in the what can we tell our kids, in the heart sickness that is my response to everything about this that is a direct violation of the values I hold most dear. And there will be so much time to say so many more things, so much time for us to try to make meaning and to strategize and to gather up hope and to build up those spiritual muscles of resilience and courage that we are going to need to get through. But for today, I want us to give some space to what we are grieving and to hold all that needs holding. I want to let us really honor the pain of this moment, because I think we won't be able to show up for the next many months and years as strong and grounded and as resilient as we are going to need to be unless we first process and metabolize some of this pain. Those of you who joined us on Thursday evening for an election processing space in this sanctuary may recognize this bowl here. This is a weeping well. It's a vessel of water filled to the brim. And when we add things, it will flow over, weeping down the side of the vessel as a way to honor all that we are grieving. So, beloveds, I would like to invite you to call into this space in a word or two, whatever it is that you are grieving today, whatever it is that you are holding that is heavy. And for each one, I will add a stone to the vessel. For all of these things, and for all that we hold, there are so many more. I add one final stone. Friends, I just want to take a few moments to just hold everything that we've heard and all that remains unspoken. We honor the grief that this moment it brings, and we say together again, we love you.
We love you.
And we will fight to keep each other safe.
We will fight to keep each other safe.
Friends, do you remember the 1965 movie, The Sound of Music? As a child, I loved this movie, all 2 hours and 52 minutes of it. And it was one of the few VHS tapes that we owned. And my cousins also loved this movie, but their version was a version recorded off of the TV. Remember how you could do that? And with all of the commercial breaks, their recorded version ended before the end of the actual movie. And in their version, the movie ended just after Rolf, who was the 17-year-old love interest of Liesl von Trapp, just after Rolf betrays the family. As they are hiding in the abbey, fleeing the Nazis, Rolf discovers the family just as they are about to escape and starts blowing his whistle, and all of the Nazis come running. And for their entire childhoods, my cousins believed that the movie ended there. Can you imagine if it did? They thought that the von Trapp family had been caught by the Nazis. That was the end of the movie. That's where the tape cut off. They thought that fascism had won, and that was the end of the story. They did not know until they were adults that there was another 20 minutes at the end of the story, at the end of the movie. They did not know that the family escaped with the help of some feisty nuns who sheltered them, the ones who removed the parts from the engines from the Nazis' cars. They did not know that Maria knows her way across the mountains to safety, those very mountains that she starts off singing in. They did not know that the story of the family went on even after the movie ended, that the family settled in the US in Vermont, and that life continued for them. It was not until my cousins were adults that they learned that that was not the end of the story. And friends, though it may feel that way this week, and though it may feel this way for a long time, I do believe that in the long arc of human history, fascism is not the end of the story. It was not the end of the story for the von Trapp family, and it's not the end of our story either. But friends, I also believe that this vote was a vote for death-making institutions and ideologies. This was a vote for the death-making institutions of white supremacy and patriarchy and nationalism and militarism and anti-Semitism and anti-Arabism, anti-trans and anti-immigrant and anti-queer. And the list goes on. And I will be very honest that part of what scares me is that I know that some people will not survive the policies and the emboldened violence and the lack of access to resources that these next couple of years will bring. In our worship planning this week, Rose and I were really at a loss for what to do with the kids. And the first thing that came to mind was this image of asking the kids to come to the center and of doing a sort of laying on of hands like we did at, have done at child dedications and surrounding them with a protective blessing. And when I said this to Rose, she and I both started tearing up and we were like, we can't do this, it'll freak the kids out. But it's an image that has really stuck with me this week, and I keep tearing up every time I tell someone about it. But I'd like to invite us to close our eyes now and to imagine putting those who are most vulnerable at the center. Maybe it's someone you know. Maybe it's yourself. Maybe it's a child in your life. Maybe it's somebody you don't know. Refugees sleeping at the Wollaston train station. Queer and trans kids in Florida. But I'd like to imagine all of us circling around and surrounding them, surrounding ourselves with our love and our protection and our action. I invite us to open our eyes and come back to this space here, holding on to those commitments and those prayers and those faces. Beloveds, there is so much we don't know about what's going to happen. But as Rose reminded us, there are also things we do know and that we can promise. First of all, we are going to fight like hell for each other. Amen?
Amen.
Amen simply means yes or so be it. We are going to fight like hell for each other. Amen?
Amen.
And we are going to fight for those who need protecting. Amen?
Amen.
And we are going to keep showing up. Amen?
Amen.
And we are going to remind each other that we are not alone. Amen?
Amen.
And we are going to hold hope for each other. Amen?
Amen.
Rebecca Solnit says that hope is not like a lottery ticket that you sit on the sofa and clutch. Hope is an axe that you break down doors with in an emergency. Hope should shove you out the door, because it will take everything you have to steer the future away from endless war, from the annihilation of the Earth's resources, from the grinding down of the poor and marginal. Hope just means another world might be possible, not promised. Hope calls for action, and action is impossible without hope. So friends, here in the midst of all of the grief, the fear, the anger, the worry, I also have a small flicker of hope. Because here's what I do know. In the long arc of human history, fascism is not the end of the story. And we have each other, and we are going to keep showing up, and we are going to keep fighting. We're going to keep showing up, and we're going to keep fighting for ourselves, and for each other, and for our kids, and for love. And for this, friends, I light a small candle of hope. Amen. Friends, I'd like to invite us to rise in body or spirit for our closing hymn, My Life Flows On. It's number 108 in your gray hymnals, and we've added one final verse, which will be on the screen. Thank you. benediction this morning comes from Wayne Arneson. It's one of my favorites. Take courage, friends. The way is often hard, the path is never clear, and the stakes are very high. Take courage, for deep down there is another truth. You are not alone. So may it be, and amen. I have a few very brief announcements before we close. First off, an invitation to join us next door in coffee hour through these doors in the parish hall next door, if you're joining us here in person, and if you're online, to stick around for breakout groups to say hello. Next Sunday, we'll be having a small group after church on the practice of repair, our monthly worship theme. If you're interested in exploring that theme a little bit more deeply after worship from 12 to 1, we'll be gathering in the parlor to discuss that theme. And finally, we have winter fair flyers available. Please see Jennifer Buchwald, and if you'd like to sign up, there's also a live sign-up genius to help. The winter fair is our main fundraiser. It happens on November 23rd. Please sign up at coffee hour to help out. See Jennifer Buchwald. Jonathan will close us out with a theme from Amelie, and again, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful to have you, Jonathan.